Yo, hello, my name is Wesbam, and welcome to another V4 tutorial. Today I want to talk about one of the most used nodes inside VVVV. I am sure you already know it, it's the LFO animation. It stands for Low Frequency Oscillator. The LFO is the heart of most patches that are using any type of animation or movement. And all it does, it counts up from 0 to 1. We can see that here in the output. So let me make an IO box. I left click, middle click, and middle click again to give it a name. And let me scale up the LFO so we can reach the pins a bit more easy. Now, I will be editing this video, so I'm sure you might notice jumps and glitches. This is me editing. The LFO really runs very smooth. Okay, the period pin. Middle mouse click for the name. The period pin says how fast it will count. And by default, it counts in 1 second. So let's make this, for example, 10 seconds. And you see the output goes slower. And if I make it 0.1 second, you will see that the output runs very, very fast. So let's set this back to 1 second. I can change the period to anything I want. So for example, if I make it a negative value, the LFO output runs backwards. And if I set it to 0 seconds, the LFO runs so freaking fast, it actually stands still. So be careful there. Okay, let me put this back to 1 second again. Well, next to the period pin, we have the pause pin. And you make a connection and you middle mouse click and you middle mouse click again. The pause is a boolean, 1 or 0. So by default it's set to 0 and that means the LFO is running, and if I right click, I can pause my output. And then we have the reverse pin. Make a connection, middle mouse click, middle mouse click. And let me unpause the LFO. Well, the reverse pin is the direction. So now it counts from 0 to 1. And if I toggle the reverse pin, I right click, the output goes down. So if I toggle it again, the output goes up again. On the output of the LFO, we have a change pin and a cycle pin. The change pin is very useful because now we have something that can bang every, in this case, 1 second. And there's also a cycle pin. And the cycle pin counts how many times the LFO has counted from 1 to 0. Or how many cycles we have done. If I reverse the LFO, the cycles will count down. Okay, next we have a reset pin, and this is a bang. So I make connection, middle mouse click, middle mouse click. If I bang the reset pin, the cycle pin and the output will start counting at 0 again. Now, when I bang the reset pin, the change pin also bangs. And to prevent that, you can put a XOR between the change and the reset pin. If I now bang the reset pin, the XOR will get a 1 for the reset pin and a 1 for the change, and that will output nothing, while it still will register the changes of the cycles of the LFO. Okay, next to this is the phase pin. Well, the phase pin has multiple functions. It's a default value for the LFO when I bang the reset pin. So to see this a bit better, let me change the period to 10 seconds. And if I now reset the LFO, it starts at 0. And if I left click, middle click, middle click, if I change the phase to 0.5, and I now reset the LFO, the output of the LFO starts with 0.5. And also notice if I drag my phase pin, I right click and drag up or down, I can manipulate the output of the LFO. This can be a very handy feature if you want to make the LFO look a bit more natural. Well, that's all I can say about the LFO. And now let's look at two nodes that are commonly used with the LFO. The most used one is the wave shaper. Wave shaper value. It has an excellent help file, so just select the node and hit F1. And here we can see the help file of the wave shaper. The wave shaper comes with different shapes, like the linear one. Now you see that the LFO just goes in a smooth line. The inverse one goes the other way around. The triangle makes you bounce the LFO. Or the sinus, which will also make the LFO bounce. But this one goes very smoothly. And a rectangle, this one is a bit weird. It's mostly like a toggle on or off. The QE node is just a buffer, and in this case it will buffer 180 frames, and it will show them all in one go, so we can see what we're doing. The shape that I use all the time is the sine, because it gives this smooth output. Another note I like to use with the LFO to shape it is the gamma note. Gamma value. So let's replace the wave shaper by the gamma. So I just connect the LFO to the input. And then I connect the output to the QE node. Now by default the gamma is set to 1 and nothing really changes. But if I lower my gamma, for example 0.5, you see it starts very fast and then goes smoother. And if I make, for example, the gamma 2, it will give me another shape for my LFO. So, wave shaper, gamma, two good friends for the LFO. Let me close the help patch. I select the patch and hit Ctrl W. I alter this patch, but I don't want to save it. So don't save and close. And let's make something easy. I'm going to make 3 quads rotating around in a renderer. So let me start all over again. I need an LFO, of course. A quad. If I middle mouse click here, I get the group node. If I middle mouse click here, I get the renderer. Let's put it somewhere I can use it. So over here we'll do, make it a bit bigger. We done this before, I know. And of course I need a transform 2D. Connect it to the quad. Move it a bit down. And I'm going to use a circular spread. Output X goes to translate X. Output Y goes to translate Y. Let's make an IOBox value advanced for the scale, so we can scale our quad. And instead of increasing the spread count for the circular spread, I'm going to make a linear spread to feed my width and height pins. So this goes to the width and this goes to the height. And I'm going to set this spread count to 3. And now we got 3 quads in our renderer. And if I connect my LFO to the face pin, we got our 3 quads running. Now they're running around the center point, so let me fix that by simply changing the input. And now we got 3 quads running in a circle. Okay, let's see how we can randomize this a bit, creating a bit of offset. So let's make a random spread. And we're going to connect this to the LFO, to the period pin. And we put the spread count on 3, of course. And if I make the input 10 and the width 3, I get 3 random values that are all a bit around 10. And you can see that here in our inspector at the output pin. So I got 11 seconds, 9 and 8.5. Now when I reset my LFO, let me make a connection for that. Now when I reset my LFO, so I bang my reset pin, all the quads start at the same location. So to create some kind of offset, we need to randomize the face pin. So when I reset, they all start at a different location. So I'm just going to simply duplicate my random seed, connect it to my face pin, change the seed a bit to something random. And if I now bang my reset pin, the quads start at a different location. Now make this a bit more weird, I'm going to increase the spread count. So I just double right click to make an IOBox value advanced. One for this random spread, one for this random spread, and one for the linear spread. And let's crank up the spread count. I'm going to put my linear spread to input 1 and a width of 2. And let's make it even higher. I'm making the quads a bit smaller. And I think I can even go higher. So if I now bang the reset pin, they all start at a random position and it makes everything look a bit more random. And if I make the face pin 1 value again and I reset, they all start in one line and you can see them start growing. And if I change the linear spread, we can make an even more interesting shape. So yeah, you can play around with this, and if you want, you can edit some color with the HSV color join. Let's give it a bit of saturation. And let's get crazy and make it a random color for every quad we have. So now we got a very easy and interesting patch using the power of the LFO node. Well, that's it for me for the LFO node. I hope you picked up some ideas. Thank you for watching. My name is Wes Bem, and I see you all next time.